of ages.
Kingdom and the power and the glory of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages.
Lord, have mercy.
For thou art a merciful God, and lovest mankind, and unfeeling. souls, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, the good estate of the holy churches of God, and for the union of all men, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for those who enter with faith, reverence, and the fear of God, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our Father and Metropolitan Joseph, the venerable priesthood, the diaconate in Christ, for all the clergy and the people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Metropolitan Paul, Archbishop John, for their quick release from captivity and safe return, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the President of the United States and all civil authorities, and for armed forces everywhere, especially Peter, Ronnie, Andrew, Joshua, Connor, Skyler, Benjamin, Thaddeus, and Adam, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city, for every city and land, and for the faithful who dwell therein, for healthful seasons, abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For travelers by sea, by land, and by air, for the sick and the suffering, for captives and their salvation, and especially for those suffering for the faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our deliverance from all affliction, wrath, danger, and need, help us, save us, have mercy on us, and keep us, O God, by thy grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Calling to remembrance our all holy, immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theotokos and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and our whole life unto Christ our God.
Blessed is in peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help us, save us, have mercy upon us, and keep us, O God, by thy grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Calling to remembrance are all holy, immaculate, most blessed, and glorious Lady Theotokos, and ever Virgin Mary with all the saints. Let us commend ourselves and each other and all our lives unto Christ our God.
Thine is the majesty, and thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and to the ages of ages.
Releasing your hand, Father.
sin, and this gift to Eve, joy in place of sadness.
And he who was incarnate to me,
both God and man, have restored to life those who have fallen therefrom. Alleluia, 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 glory to thee, O God. Alleluia, 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 glory to thee, O God. Alleluia, 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 glory to thee, O God.
Father, and to the
ye may be accounted worthy to hear the holy gospel, let us pray to the Lord God.
Have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Wisdom attend, let us hear the holy gospel.
Peace be to all.
And to thy spirit.
Reading from the holy gospel according to St. John.
Glory to thee, O Lord.
Revealed himself to the disciples after he was raised from the dead, and said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, you love me more than these. Peter said to them, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my lambs. A second time Jesus said to Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? Peter said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Tend my sheep. Jesus said to Peter the third time, Simon, son of Jonah, you love me. Peter was grieved because Jesus said to him the third time, You love me. And Peter said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my sheep. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you girded yourself and walked where you would. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will gird you and carry you where you do not wish to go. This he said to show by what death Peter was to glorify God. And after this, Jesus said to Peter, Follow me. Peter turned and saw following them the disciple whom Jesus loved, who had lain close to his breast at the supper, and had said, Lord, who is it that is going to betray you? When Peter saw him, he said to Jesus, Lord, what about this man? Jesus said to him, If it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? Follow me. The saying spread abroad among the brethren that this disciple was not to die, yet Jesus did not say that he was not to die. But if it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? This is the disciple who is bearing witness to these things, and who has written these things, and we know that his testimony is true. But there are also many other things which Jesus did. Were every one of them to be written, I suppose that the world itself would not contain the books that would be written of them.
Glory to thee, O Lord, glory to thee.
In that day we held the resurrection of Christ, let us bow down before the Holy Lord Jesus, the only sinless one. I cross to you, Lord of Christ, and I believe resurrection, we praise and glorify. For thou art our God, and we know none other besides thee. We call upon thy name. O come, all ye faithful, let us adore Christ's holy resurrection. For lo, to the cross is joy coming to all the world. Ever blessing the Lord, let us sing his resurrection. For that he endured the cross for us, he is destroyed death by death.
Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy great mercy, according to thy compassion, blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin, for I know my iniquity and my sin is ever before you. Against you only have I sinned, and done evil before you, that thou mightest be justified in thy word. And to go when thou art judged. Behold, I was conceived in iniquities, and sin to my mother bear me. For behold, thou wilt love truth, and even see good things in thy wisdom. Hast thou made manifest unto me? Thou shalt sprinkle me with this, and thou shalt be made clean. Thou shalt wash me, and thou shalt be made white as snow. Thou shalt give me your joy and gladness, and bones that be humble, they shall rejoice. Turn thy face away from my sins, blot out all my iniquities. Create me a clean heart, God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, with thy loving spirit, such me. I shall teach upon the rest of thy ways, and God shall turn back unto me. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, the God of my salvation. My son shall rejoice in my righteousness. O Lord, thou shalt open my lips, and my mouth shall declare thy praise. But thou hast desired sacrifice, and behold, my offering thou shalt not be pleased. A sacrifice to God, unto God is a broken spirit, a heart that is broken and humble, God will not despise. The good Lord, thy pleasure to God, and the love of the truth will be built up. Then shalt thou be pleased with the sacrifice of righteousness, with oblation or whole burnt offering, and then shall they offer bullets.
Is it thy world with mercy and compassion? Exalt the horn of Orthodox Christians, and send down upon us thy rich mercies. Through the intercessions of our all-immaculate Lady Theotokos and ever-Virgin Mary, by the might of the precious and life-giving cross, by the protection of the honorable, bodiless powers of heaven, at the supplication of the honorable, glorious prophet, forerunner and Baptist John, of the holy, glorious, all laudable apostles, Peter and Paul, and all the holy apostles, of our fathers among the saints, great hierarchs and ecumenical teachers, Basil the Great, Gregory the Theologian, and John Chrysostom, Athanasius, Cyril, and John the Merciful, Patriarchs of Alexandria, Nicholas of Myra, Spiridon of Trimethos, and Nectarios of Metopolis, the wonder workers, of our fathers among the saints, Tikhon, Patriarch of Moscow, and Raphael, Bishop of Brooklyn, of the holy, glorious, great martyrs, George the Trophy Bearer, Demetrios the Mercer, Theodore the Soldier, Theodore the General, and Aeneas the Wonder Worker, of the higher martyrs, Ignatius the God-Bearer of Antioch, Charalampos and Eleutherios, of the holy, glorious, great women martyrs, Thecla, Barbara, Anastasia, Catherine, Kyriaki, Botini, Marina, Periskeva, and Irene, of the holy, glorious, bright, victorious martyrs, of our venerable and God-bearing fathers who shone in the ascetic life, of Saint Barnabas, the patron and protector of this holy community, of the holy and righteous ancestors of God, Joachim and Anna, of the holy, glorious, and right, victorious martyrs, Bodios and Anikythos of Nicomedia, whose memory we celebrate today, and of all thy saints, we beseech thee, O most merciful Lord, hearken unto the petitions of us sinners who make our supplications unto thee, and have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Thank you. Spirit, Glory to the flesh, shown us the light. Glory.
kingdom of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, now and ever and to ages of ages.
Thank you. Oh, at us. The Lord is my strength and my song. The Lord has chastened me sorely.
Wisdom.
The reading is from St. Paul's letter to the Corinthians.
Let us again.
Brethren, you are the seal of my apostleship in the Lord. This is my defense to those who would examine me. Do we not have the right to our food and drink? Do we not have the right to be accompanied by a wife, as the apostles and the brother of the Lord, and Cephas? Or is it only Barnabas and I who have no right to refrain, from working for a living? Who serves as a soldier at his own expense? Who plants a vineyard without eating any of its fruit? Who tends a flock without getting some of the milk? Do I say this on human authority? Does not the law say the same? For it is written in the law of Moses, you shall not muzzle an ox when it is treading out the grain. Is it for the oxen that God is concerned? Does he not speak entirely for our sake? It was written for our sake, because the plowman should plow in hope, and the thresher thresh in hope of a share in the crop. If we have sown spiritual good among you, is it too much if we reap your material benefits? If others share this rightful claim upon you, do not we still more? Nevertheless, we have not made use of this right, but we endure anything rather than put an obstacle in the way of the gospel of Christ.
Peace be to thee that readeth.
To thy spirit.
Children and all that he had and payment to be made. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the Lord of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. But that same servant, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down and besought him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. He refused and went and put him in prison till he should pay the debt. When his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their Lord all that had taken place. Then his Lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you besought me. And should not you have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his Lord delivered him to the jailers till he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart.
name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God. Today's gospel lesson featured the parable of the unforgiving servant. The message of the story is so abundantly clear, it doesn't require further explanation or interpretation. Very simply, we must forgive others as we have been forgiven by God, period. And yet, while this requires no interpretation, it desperately requires application whenever we become the victims of an offense. Sadly, when forgiveness is most needed to be expressed by us, we are often overtaken by our passions to demand justice be given to us instead. Of course, you know, we're experts at rationalizing to justify ourselves. We say, of course, it's not justice that I want, you know. We assure ourselves that we just want things set right, that's all. We want the offender perhaps to acknowledge his sin, maybe to apologize. We want our reputation to be restored. We want assurance that never, ever again in the history of man will that offense happen. And we want to be appeased and placated. But other than that, we forgive and remember. We demand the rightings of wrongs far beyond what God demands of us. And why is this so? Is it because the offenses against us are infinitely greater than our offenses against God? Probably not. Or is it because we're simply not God? We lack the love of God, the mercy and compassion, and the long-suffering toward sinners that God has. Whatever humility, whatever imitation of Christ that we are able to gain in this life can be instantly evaporated in the white-hot flash of our passions when we are offended. We must understand, and I think this is really crucial, that we are absolutely ruled by our passions until we learn to live otherwise. So all of our logic and all of our rationalizing and all, you know, the talk that we do to justify ourselves, that's not wisdom. That's just the passions trying to assert themselves, trying to insist that it's okay that they rule. Selfishness, greed, fear, anger, lust, to name a few, lead so many of our reactions to the stimuli of daily life that we rarely allow ourselves to respond outside of them in a godly manner. We react rather than respond. You understand what I'm getting at here? It's like the raising of children. A good parent knows that he or she must learn to respond to his child, not merely react out of emotion or passion. A careful, measured response to childish misdeeds is far more beneficial than an angry reaction, which comes out of the passions. Of course, this requires that we pause and think before we act. You know, a great personal sacrifice. Can't just blow up, can't just act out of passions, but we stop, we think, we make a measured response. But you know, we do this, and why do we do this? Because we love our kids and we count them worthy of that extra effort to not just vent and feel good, but to stop and respond instead of reacting. We want our kids to experience the respect and the dignity that's conveyed by a measured response rather than suffer the sting of an outburst of parental frustration. And moms especially don't feel guilty right now. Because nobody's 100%. But you know the spirit of what I'm getting at. Sometimes we blow up and, you know, we just, you know, it happens. But that's not, hopefully, the norm for us, and it's not our goal. But if we're willing to show such love to our kids, to make that effort to respond not out of passion, not out of justifying ourselves, but out of love, out of concern, out of what's best for them, then why don't we show the same love for one another when we step on each other's toes or offend one another? I'm not advocating that we treat each other like children, but I think it would not be a bad idea
if we showed maybe the same love, the same concern, the same ownership, you know, like we are a part of one another, we are family, and we owe each other a debt of love and forbearance and mercy, such as we show to our own kids. Well, my advice when someone offends you is to count, first of all, that person as worthy of all love and the best treatment that you can give. Because that's how, usually, when on a good day, that's how we'll treat our kids when they misbehave. We don't say, oh, I hate you, I wish you were never born. I hope. But, you know, we react in a good way. But when it comes to somebody else, it's, you know, it's not always the same treatment that we give. We need to count that person as worthy of love, worthy of good, respectful treatment. Do not react to your passions, but respond in the Spirit of God. And here's the thing about forgiveness, a couple of things. One is, if we dare demand an apology for any offense, we've missed the opportunity to forgive, to be like God, to show mercy, to show forbearance. We don't often think of it that way. We think of an apology as something that is owed. A debt has been made, and this is owed. But even God's justice doesn't work that way, at least not in the East. We forgive. We forgive. And if you're angry, if you demand, like I say, an apology, demand things to be set right, you've completely missed an opportunity to simply forgive. That's a terrible thing. Terrible opportunity to miss. You know, God doesn't care for your ego. He's not concerned one whit about your self-esteem or, you know, that you defend your pride or your good name. All the time where we take offense, you know, someone says this, someone looks at us the wrong way. And we take offense, and, you know, when actually we ought to be happy with people. Harm us in that way, when people assault our ego, bruise us, we ought to be happy. Because that thing needs to die. What are we going to do? Take it, preserve it carefully, like an Asian pear, you know, wrap it in a little styrofoam, you know, make sure it doesn't suffer any bruises, so that when we stand before Christ, we say, here is my pride, perfectly preserved. You know, we hope that thing gets the snot beat out of it, right, in this life, that it's mortified, that it dies. And yet, when every time it takes even the smallest bug, we rush to its defense. Kind of hypocritical that way, don't you think? God cares not for our ego, for our pride, but He cares that we take every opportunity to imitate Christ, who forgave even the men who were crucifying Him. They didn't apologize. They didn't acknowledge their wrongdoing. But He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. If we want to be like Christ, we don't wait for an apology. I've actually had people tell me, I haven't forgiven that person because they haven't repented. What kind of screwball world do you live in? I mean, but they, you know, people's reasoning, and you know, you might even say it's reflected in some of the theology of the West that, you know, you have to ask God to forgive you before He'll save you, and or to receive His forgiveness. And, you know, the Orthodox, we just don't think that way. God is love. God forgives. You know, so He's not waiting for us to do something to forgive us or to love us. He does. And that's the way we need to respond to people. They don't have to crucify their firstborn in order for us to forgive them. We don't have to wait for things to be set right. We don't have to wait for damage to be recompensed if we want to be like Christ. Forgiveness Vespers, I say this, I think, just about every year because I'm not very original. But, you know, when we have Forgiveness Vespers before the start of Great Lent, what do? We set up booths outside so people can talk first and discuss their issues with each other so they can come in and forgive each other with clear conscience, and we don't. You don't need to talk. You just forgive. We don't need to say, you know, I really want and need for you to understand how you hurt me with your cruel, mean words. No, you just forgive. You don't need justice. You don't need things straightened out. You don't need the other person to acknowledge their evils against you. You just need to forgive. There's the grace right there. There's the presence of God. Forgive. St. Paul lamented the quarreling among some of the Corinthians. He wrote, "Now therefore there is utterly a fault among you, because ye know the law, one against another. Why do you not rather accept wrong? Why do you not rather suffer yourselves to be defrauded?" In other words, why did not rather be like Christ, who, when he was reviled, did not revile in return? When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. St. Peter would later write, "When we are in the throes of our passions, we forget Christ, and we demand a level of justice and retribution that even he himself would not demand." What we really need to forget is justice. We just need to forget the idea of justice. You know, God is not just. If he were just, you would perish in your sins. God does not act toward us in justice. He did not kill his son to preserve justice. This is false theology, and it's crept into a lot of our thinking because we come from that background. God is love, God is forgiveness, God is mercy. And when we demand some kind of justice, I mean, justice shouldn't even be a part of our vocabulary. It doesn't exist. There is only love, which trumps justice. Forgive me for saying trump in a homily. So whenever we take offense and demand something to be done, a person just at least needs to say something to me, to apologize, you know, whatever. Once again, we're missing the opportunity to be like Christ, to simply forgive, to love, to care about that person more than my own stinking ego. And if we miss an opportunity to forgive, this is a great loss. It is a true loss, far more serious than any bump or bruise to our pride or our ego. To lose the opportunity to forgive is an eternal loss. Take forgiveness seriously and overcome the passions with love. With the glory of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you. President of the United States and all civil authorities and our own forces everywhere. The Lord God, remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. Servants of God, especially for the Archpriest Swain and his family, for Colleen and her family, for Sean, Ivan, Nicola, Joe, Wanda, for John, for Hannah, for Nadia, for Angela, and for Destiny, that they have mercy, life, peace, health, salvation, visitation, pardon, and remission of their sins. The Lord God, remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. Amen. For the Orthodox servants of God departed this life, especially for the newly departed Kevin, the Lord God remembered them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Ever into the ages of ages.
Amen.
of one another, that with one accord we may confess.
Thank you. Now and ever, to the ages of ages. God and Savior Jesus Christ be with all of you.
Through the glory of God. precious blood. Wherefore I pray thee, have mercy upon me, and forgive my transgressions, both voluntary and involuntary, of word and deed, of knowledge and ignorance, and many who were to partake of thy condemnation, of thy banquet of mysteries, unto remission of my sins, and unto life everlasting. Amen.
Of thy mystic supper, O Son of God, accept me today as a human, for I will not speak of thy mystery to my enemies, neither will I give thee against death to Judas, but I will be quiet and confess thee. Remember me, O Lord, in thy kingdom, not into judgment, nor into condemnation. Be my partaker of thy good wishes, O Lord, and let the healing of the soul of all mine.
Thank you. stand. Good stand.
If the fear of God with faith and love draw near,
thank you.
message of hope. Always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. Sponsors, you know, those closest, but you know, really all of us
up here, but for sake of not overcrowding.
O God, according to thy great goodness, we pray thee, hearken and have mercy.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Again, we pray for the repose of the soul of the servant of God, Kevin. Depart this life, and that thou wilt pardon his every transgression, both voluntary and involuntary.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
That the Lord God will establish his soul where the just repose, the mercies of God, the kingdom of heaven, and remission of his sins, let us ask of Christ, our immortal King and our God.
Given life to thy world. Do thou, the same Lord, give rest to the soul of thy departed servant, Kevin, in a place of brightness, a place of virtue, a place of repose, whence all sickness, sorrow, and sighing have bled away. Pardon every sin which he hath committed, whether by word or deed or thought, for thou art good and lovest mankind. But there is no man who liveth and sinneth not. And thou only art without sin, and thy righteousness is to all eternity, and thy law is true. For thou art the resurrection, and the life, and the repose of thy departed servant, Kevin, O Christ our God. And unto thee we ascribe glory together with thy Father as of everlasting, and that all holy, good, and life-giving Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages, on ages.
Thank you.
Holy Fathers, Lord Jesus Christ, our God, have mercy on us and save us. Archbishop of Constantinople, whose divine liturgy we have now celebrated, of the holy, glorious, and great victorious martyrs, of our venerable and God-fearing fathers, of Saint Barnabas, patron and protector of this holy community, of the holy and righteous ancestors of God, Joachim and Anna, of the holy, glorious, and right victorious martyrs, Gorios and Anathetos of Nicomedia's memory we celebrate today, and of all the saints, have mercy upon us and save us, for as much as he is good and love us, spend God. Through the prayers of our holy fathers, Lord Jesus Christ, our God, have mercy on us and save us.